lost Shahzad Rafati from Broadband TV. I don't know where she is. Somewhere on the New Mexico. No problem, we're going to talk with this unbelievable guy, with Sam Dolnick, Associate Editor Digital from the New York Times. Just to let you know what he's doing. Yes, you can give him a round of applause. Already fans in Germany and Europe here. Sam, too good to have you, because to get a feeling for what you are doing, his office is the newsroom of the New York Times, located at the Times Square in New York City. And you are usually, at this time already in New York, it's early in the morning,
yeah.
You're sitting in the newsroom doing what?
Yeah, I sit in the newsroom among all the journalists, and my job, not too long ago, I was a reporter writing stories and then an editor sending out other reporters to write stories. But a few years ago, our executive editor realized that we needed a new job. It was a job called a mobile editor. And the job didn't have much definition, but the assignment was, all of our readers are moving towards the phone. We need to figure out what to do about it. And it was an open-ended question. So my job was to, you know, still from the newsroom as a journalist, try to understand how this incredible shift to the mobile phone would affect our audience and affect how people find our stories, and most importantly, affect how we tell our stories.
You're talking about audience, not about readers.
Right.
Because if you think the New York Times, the Gray Lady, such a great history, everybody's talking about readers, but for you, it's all about audience. We're talking about building a global media platform business, changing audience required changing business. The change. Could you describe maybe the change in the New York Times? Because I think if you go back, let me say, 5 years,
yeah,
almost every job in the New York Times has a new profile right now.
That's right. It's on the business side, in the newsroom, everyone has reinvented themselves. You've really had to. The business has changed that much. It's a smart point that we talk about our audience instead of our readers. We publish, you know, dozens of videos every day across every platform, social media, our own platforms, the phone, the desktop. So we have people who know us only through our videos. We publish podcasts. Our latest political podcast has been downloaded more than a million times. So we have people who know us through audio. We publish virtual reality films. We're, you know, the pioneer there, really moving aggressively into it. We can talk about VR. So to think of us as readers or even as, you know, words first is really becoming increasingly old-fashioned. We look at our for us, the question is, what's the story of the day? And then what's the best way to tell it? Sometimes the answer is through words, a traditional newspaper story, but often the answer is through a video or through a visual story or through photographs or through virtual reality. And we have all of these storytelling weapons in our arsenal now.
In the beginning, there was one digital section and one print unit, journalists working parallel, not together. How do you connect that?
Yeah, it was a serious cultural change. They were, as you say, entirely separate. Maybe a decade ago, we joined the newsroom, so it was one. But there was still such a deep tradition of print first that people really thought of their jobs as writing for the newspaper. And then that news, that print story, would get translated and thrown up onto the web. But people really were looking newspaper first. Over the past 5 years or so, that's changed dramatically. So now people are writing for the web, which means they're writing immediately, as quickly as something happens, as quickly as they can post to Twitter, they're writing for our website. And they're building out that story through the day for our digital audience. And then at the end of the day, it gets translated back into print. So it's really a reversal of where we've gone. And it's been a big cultural transformation over the past several years that, you know, I think more than anything, it's because our journalists live in the world too, and they know how they're obsessed with their phones just like anybody else. And we know that's how people are finding us every day, and that's where we want to be, in the center of the conversation.
The New York Times is maybe one of the brands talking about newspapers, talking about a source of information. It's an icon, and it was something, if you hold it in your hands, something you really got something. when you know just an app or another possibility to get information digitally, do you still have the chance to be that icon, to have that extraordinary position in press worldwide?
Yeah, I mean, that's the big question. And it's worth saying, print isn't going anywhere. We still have, you know, over a million print subscribers who value that physical feeling of getting the paper every day. And it still is a singular experience. We have the Sunday magazine, we have a Style magazine. These are great print experiences. So we still certainly are excited about that. But you're absolutely right. The future is going to be on the phone. And we've got huge portions of the world who never see us in print and now never see us on the desktop. They only know us through the phone. So the challenge is to try and build that same loyalty that the print newspaper has instilled in generations of people through the phone. And the way that we think about that is to try and be a daily habit. You know, we don't think that it's good enough for the Times to just pop up in your social feed, for you to occasionally see us in Facebook or Twitter. You will see us there, of course, but we need to be much more than that. We want to be part of your daily routine so that when something new, when big news happens, you instinctively open the New York Times app. And when you wake up in the morning, you open the New York Times app, and that we're baked into the rhythm of your daily life so that we're recreating the same same print experience. We're creating a new one for the phone.
And if you look at a journey of this is what you want and where are we right now, so do you think you're really the audience really feels what you want to do, or is it still a journey that you're on?
I mean, it's a journey for sure. The world is changing so quickly that I don't think we'll ever be able to say we did it. You know, as soon as we crack upon the way to solve mobile phones, then it's going to be the watches or the glasses, or we're on a constant flow of transformation. But yet we're learning a lot about how our mobile audience works and what our readers and viewers want from us. So just, you know, a tiny example. Every day now we publish something called the Daily Briefing. We never did this before in print. This was an innovation for mobile. And all it is a simple rundown of the headlines of the day. But mm-hmm. it's told in kind of a conversational, chatty voice, the kind of voice you would find in social media. And it gets you up to speed with all of the big stories. It's quick and it's easy. That's become something that our readers really value. And we put it right at the front of the top of the app so that mm-hmm. every day people open the app and they read the Daily Briefing. That small little innovation is the kind of thing that makes people open it every day and has led people to start subscribing and thinking of us as part of their daily habit.
How important is video content for you?
Huge. Absolutely enormous. You know, we've all seen the trends across social media, and the New York Times sees the same numbers. We live in a visual world now. People want to experience, they don't want to just read about the protests last night in London. They want to see it for themselves. So we have a robust video team across the world. On every continent, we have video journalists who are both filing live stories and also telling, you know, doing their own enterprise journalism, making short documentaries that tell stories every bit as impactful and meaningful as print, but through video.
Do you get your footage only from your own teams, or where else do you get your video content from?
Some of our most creative video journalists are actually experts. I mean, real wizards at mining the social web for video. So if something happens, if a bomb goes off in Morocco, they're able to reverse engineer and see all of the social postings that went from that one square mile. And then they can instantly scroll through Instagram and Twitter and find the videos and then compile that into citizen journalism. It's a really powerful, visceral experience. And so we see that as absolutely as meaningful as the video journalism that our own folks produce.
And how can you guarantee the quality of your journalistic work if you see the tradition of the New York Times, the printed edition, and what you're doing right now? Is it the same level?
Absolutely. I mean, that's crucial to us. And that's part of the reason, you know, I was an investigative reporter, I was a foreign correspondent, grew up steeped in traditional journalistic values. And so now a big part of my job is trying to bring those values into places like virtual reality and places like audio. And it means working with journalists who are ambitious and creative so that You know, I'll give you an example. Last year, we made our first virtual reality film. This was a whole new medium. We didn't know how to work in virtual reality. We, like everybody else, were still figuring out what virtual reality even was, what it was for. But we sent a Pulitzer Prize winning video journalist, Ben Solomon, who has reported from Africa on Ebola and around the world. We gave him one of these virtual reality cameras and we said, we want you to figure it out. Use your same journalistic eyes, your credibility, and bring it to this new medium. And he did, and it was one of our most important pieces of journalism of the year.
You mentioned that you had to change the newsroom a lot.
Yeah.
We're always talking about change is a big word, everywhere's changed, but you really did it.
Yeah.
Maybe we can learn something from the New York Times, how to manage to get really the whole staff, the whole team on board.
Yeah.
What was the secret of success for this change in an unbelievable established newsroom?
Yeah, I mean, we're still figuring it out, but a big part of it was what you said before, convincing everyone in the room that writing digital journalism did not mean lowering our standards at all. That was probably the first hurdle. And people were skeptical. You know, there's all kinds of blogs out there that aggregate or make up facts. We're not interested in that. We're doing New York Times level journalism. And so that was probably the first battle to convince everyone that we needed to bring our standards into this new world. And then the second piece of it was explaining to the newsroom how important it was. And the way to do that, honestly, the most effective way was through data. You know, our journalists want to be read. They want to have an impact on the world. That's why we all got into this business. We could show them how it worked. When we aren't paying attention to Facebook and social media and Twitter, when we are operating in the old assumptions that because we're the New York Times, people will come to us, we're going to be forgotten. That doesn't work anymore. You have to go fight for your audience and earn your audience and find where your audience is and speak to them there. So kind of showing the data and showing our newsroom where our readers were going and convincing them we can go with them without losing our soul, without lowering our standards, was the big battle. And then it became a matter of, okay, once everyone's on board, how do we do it? And that was the next trick.
And how has the rise of mobile changed the journalism itself? What's the difference between the digital journalism now and the journalism it used to be at the New York Times 5 years ago?
Yeah, that was the big question. You know, I think with the rise of the mobile phone, everyone thought that this would mean only little short stories would work and nobody would read anything long. That's not true at all. You know, our Sunday magazine publishes 5,000 word cover stories, 10,000 word cover stories every week. They're always among the most read stories. People want to read on the phone. It's actually a great reading experience, and they want to find excellent content, no matter the length or the format. So that's been one very heartening thing for us, is that good traditional journalism still works on the phone. But the phone's an extraordinary machine. It allows you to do things we could never have done before. So some of the mobile experiments we've done, we did a story that took advantage of the phone's ability, its geolocation ability. The phone knows where you are, and so our journalism knew where you were. So if you were reading the story in New York, you read a certain version of the story that talked about the poverty rates in New York. If you were reading the story in Washington, D.C., the text of the story changed. If you were in California, it was telling you about the poverty rates where you were. So we could never do that in print. You know, this is a dynamically changing story that the phone allowed us to do. I think the biggest example of what the phone can do is virtual reality for us. This is a medium, for those of you, if you haven't seen it before, that people have been talking about for a long time, but it's only now becoming real. And the reason it's becoming real is because of the phone. So this little machine can become, with something as simple as a cardboard box, a virtual reality player that transports you, really, to another world, to anywhere that the journalist can take you. So we've been aggressively exploring the limits of virtual reality journalism and the power of it and how it can complement our report. That's mobile journalism. That's something you couldn't do even 5 years ago in the desktop era. But we think that it's a tremendous way to bring our audience even closer to the stories that we care about.
Mobile journalism, digital journalism means, of course, there is no order of working anymore like it used to be. There is no deadline anymore.
Well, you're always on deadline now.
Yeah, but give us some insights of the New York Times. How do you work in shifts? Is it 24 hours? How does your newsroom really work?
Yeah, it's absolutely 24 hours.
It's 24/7.
It's 24/7. We've got newsrooms around the world. We've got a fantastic team in London that when New York goes to bed, they kind of take over the reins. And so they're keeping the website and the mobile phones updated dynamically, and then they pass it on to Hong Kong. So we're editing all around the world throughout the day. But the main thing, the main difference is, it used to be something happens and then you've got a few hours to chew it over with your editors and the print deadline is at 6:30 p.m. and that's when you have to write. Now, of course, something happens and you're writing immediately and the readers are kind of along with the journey. So we're inventing new forms on the fly. So the presidential elections right now are, of course, the big story in the U.S. During the debates, we have to cover that live. So what we've done is we have our two of our best journalists in a live conversation through a chat app, speaking to one another, digesting along with you what they're hearing, while there's another journalist who's then doing a fact check in real time against what they're saying, and then another journalist who's writing a story for the website, and then still another who's writing the story for tomorrow's front page.
You did that fact check live, and so the reader, the audience, they really had the chance to say, okay, have you heard about that? What the New York Times said it's not true or it's true, which
exactly.
is really an absolutely unbelievable thing because it's really something that helps to understand what's going on live.
Exactly, and it's an example of how, you know, lots of people, you know, talk, you know, about all of the terrible changes that the mobile landscape has brought. For us, we see it as a giant opportunity where we can do things like fact check live. Like, that's public service journalism that we could never have done before.
Talking about the monetization, do you really earn money with that, and how?
Yeah, we do. I mean, we're fortunate in that we've got a really strong subscription business. We've got over 1 million digital subscribers. We're one of the only publications that has that. And so what that audience wants from us is great journalism. And what their subscriptions allow us to do is great journalism. So it's this virtual loop that feeds itself. We, of course, have a giant advertising business as well. But we are now moving towards subscription first, where the most important constituency is our subscribers. And we know from the data what they value above all else is that kind of signature journalism that you're talking about.
You mentioned VR several times.
Yeah.
What is really the VR future of the New York Times?
We think VR is going to be a big part of how we tell stories. VR, you know, we're not interested in virtual reality for its own sake. We're interested in innovative ways of telling stories. And we see that increasingly to be visual. We're interested in immersing you in the story in ways that we never could. Virtual reality is a really powerful way to do that. And part of what's so appealing is that anybody can watch this stuff. It's on the phone. We have a free app, NYTVR, that has a gallery of the 24 films that we've published, but also films that from the Sundance Film Festival, just great VR content that you can experience. We see, you know, when our first virtual reality film took place in a refugee camp. We followed three displaced children who had to flee their homes. And it was a crushing, powerful film. I showed it to a foreign correspondent at the time who was on home leave, and she watched the whole thing and put the headset down. And she said, great, I'm obsolete. What do you need me for? I could never write like this. That's not true at all. Our print journalists, our writers, are crucial at providing the context and the analysis and asking the hard questions. That's not going to go away. But virtual reality, she's right, can do things that she can't do. It can bring the readers to the story. In the VR film, you make eye contact with this 12-year-old girl, Hana, who had to flee her home in Syria. The power of that, of seeing her, is worth 1,000 feature stories about refugees.
There are a lot of people here, they're also interested in the technology behind that.
Yeah.
How complicated is it to produce VR content like that? And how expensive is it?
Yeah, the world is moving so quickly, it's astonishing. When our first film we published last November, so 10 months ago, and it already feels like ancient history. It was a expensive, hard, cumbersome camera rig that we essentially built on our own to use. If you picture GoPro cameras strapped around a volleyball, there's maybe 10 of them, and it films every side.
Heavy.
It's heavy.
Heavy on a stick.
And then the complicated part is that you press record 10 times on each of these cameras, then you've got footage from all these cameras, and you have to stitch it all together into one experience. It's incredibly expensive and slow.
I made my own experience with that. A lot of work.
Yeah, it's terrible. Yeah. That is.
But that's gone.
It's quickly becoming obsolete. Now the cameras that Google and others are making, they do all that stitching in the cloud. So we're getting to a point where virtual reality is easy to produce, where it's not that expensive. And I think, you know, we're just going to see that accelerate as the cameras and the software and the mobile phones all improve, so that technology won't be the hurdle. Then it will just be storytelling. That's the contest. Who can tell the best stories? And we're confident there.
You tell the stories for your audience, for your customers, for your listeners, for your readers, for your viewers. How old are these people at the New York Times? Because I think the guys who have the printed edition, they're a little bit older than the audience you get. Do you have a lot of data about them? I'm sure you have.
Yeah.
So give us some insights. How old are they?
I mean, our audience runs the gamut. You're right. Our print audience skews older. It's more expensive, and it's you know, a different habit. Our Facebook audience is much younger, you know, in their mid-20s. Our mobile audience is around the world, very international, and it skews the entire gamut. But yeah, the more mobile projects that we do, the younger our audience skews.
What's the next great experiment for publishers, for media houses? What do you expect? What's coming up next?
We just did one in Rio at the Olympics that we see a lot of potential in, and we'll be doing a lot more. We had a deputy sports editor there, Sam Manchester. He was at the scene, and he covered the games through instant messages, through SMS, so that we bypass the website, the app, we bypass that entirely. You signed up for this, some 20,000 readers did, and Sam would send you a text message directly from the games. And he would send you sometimes results, here's who won, sometimes funny little postcards. He would send you GIFs from the scene. It was this, he had this kind of funny, playful tone, and it really felt like your friend had the best access in the world to the most interesting event. People really, really liked that, and it forged a new connection between the Times and our audience. People who are always on their phone, their whole lives take place in SMS. Now we're finding that the New York Times can be part of that conversation. So the opportunity there, do we cover the political elections through SMS? Should we cover Fashion Week that way? Do we cover a breaking news event through SMS? We're going to be experimenting in all of that, but I think it's a really exciting opportunity.
If we talk about the future, we have to talk about the future of the United States of America.
Yeah.
It's not a part of that discussion, actually, but a lot of people from Europe are here looking at the United States. You just mentioned the elections right now. What's going on there? What are your expectations? Who's going to be the next president?
I think that the week leading up to the presidential election will break all of our traffic records at the New York Times. people can't get enough of this story. It's just incredibly riveting. The stakes could
not be
higher.
So every day you say thank Donald Trump for showing up, or?
We're doing a lot of good journalism into this really, really important race, and it's really resonating.
And where's the journey going to?
Oh, not in the business of predictions. I can't make
that.
I've been wrong every single time so far.
last question, because you are mainly a journalist, and I know you're looking around here for new stories, for new things, for new developments.
Yeah.
Did you find the time to have a look around here at the New Mexico? What is new for you, and what is what you bring back to New York?
Yeah, what I'm most intrigued by, and we've seen a lot of conversations about it, is augmented reality. You know, virtual reality, as I say, we've been playing around with the goggles. Augmented reality feels like kind of the next chapter, where you're starting to merge the virtual world and the real world. I've seen a bunch of apps and products who are starting to explore with that, and I think there's huge potential there for journalism, for storytelling, for all kinds of experiences.
Is there still a gap between Europe and the United States, talking about journalism digitally driven?
It doesn't feel like a gap. The journalists here, we compete against them on all the big stories, and you know, they absolutely understand where their audience is and on the mobile phone. We see lots of exciting, innovative stuff coming. No, we feel very competitive.
Thank you so much. It was great talking
to you.
Even if you're only two, thanks to him and thanks to his insights from the New York Times. Thank you very much for coming along.
That's fine.
Safe trip back. Thanks.